It is known only to the almanac readers that in 1972, the official order of finish in the Electoral College was 1, Nixon, 2, McGovern, 3, Hospers. Hospers. He was the presidential candidate of the Libertarian Party and the naughty elector in Virginia who voted for him instead of for Nixon was Roger Lee MacBride, who is this year running himself as president of the Libertarian Party. Whereas Hospers achieved only about 10,000 popular votes in the state or two that permitted him on the ballot, this time candidate MacBride predicts there will be 35 states carrying his ballot, and he predicts anywhere from 1 million to 10 million votes. Votes for what? I like best the recent digest done by James Jackson Kilpatrick, who reported on the Libertarian Convention. Under a libertarian regime, he wrote, no person would talk to a census taker. No one would have to go to school. The public schools, indeed, would be abolished. Those who wanted to create private schools could do their own thing. The libertarians want private ownership of all public utilities. They are dead set against gun control. Some of their spokesmen would abolish tax-supported police departments, fire departments, and highway departments. In their utopia, people would smoke pot, make love, carry concealed weapons, take any medicine, and manage their property as they darn well pleased. Civil rights laws would be repealed. No restaurateur would be compelled to serve a customer against his will. They would do away with paper money and get back the gold. They would kill off the Federal Reserve, drastically reduce taxes, and abolish all laws having to do with child labor, minimum wages, and compulsory unionism. We oppose all government subsidies to business, labor, education, agriculture, science, broadcasting, the arts, or any other special interests, said Mr. MacBride. They would abolish selective service and grant total amnesty to draft dodgers and deserters. Did I mention the post service? Out it goes, root, branch, and mailbox. Roger MacBride is a graduate of Princeton and of the Harvard Law School. He practiced law in New York City, then went to Vermont and joined the legislature and ran for governor. Then he went to Virginia and became a television producer. He is, among other things, the producer of Little House on the Prairie, a television series. I should like to begin by announcing that in a moment there will be a question. I should like to begin by asking Mr. MacBride whether it is correct to describe his movement as anarchy or merely as anarchical.
No, of course not, Bill. We're no more anarchists than Thomas Jefferson or Patrick Henry or Tom Paine. If by anarchy you mean the kind of bomb-throwing property destruction that's going on in Lebanon now, then it almost borders on the criminal to even bring the word up in connection with our party. We are very firmly in favor of private property and of individual rights, and we're just as far from anarchy at the current time as can possibly be conceived.
Well, anarchy is a term that you dismiss with much more contempt than some of the people who follow your movement and subscribe to it, who are fairly proud to call themselves anarchists. As we know, anarchy doesn't necessarily require you to follow a Nikhaevite line of bomb throwing. It simply means the
absence of laws. Well, that seems to be the form it's taking today in the world. Of course, there are theorists like Lysander Spooner and Murray Rothbard and others who like to suppose a society in which people can handle law enforcement and the other problems of their existence without resort to government force. But in 1976, as the presidential candidate of the Libertarian Party and as the carrier of the flag for its platform, I stand as one who is in favor of the principle of individual liberty and who's advocating the need to turn the present government around and head in a direction of less control over all our lives.
Well, then you are not requiring your backers to share a particular vision of the society fulfilled. You're simply asking them to join with you in propelling our society in a particular direction.
Exactly. We want to lay the foundations for that kind of individualist, pluralist society that we're convinced the Founding Fathers, amongst others, had as a vision for this country. Our fundamental belief is that every individual ought to be free to conduct his or her life the way that person sees fit, so long as he or she is peaceful and doesn't impose on others by force or fraud. Now, that by no means means that we advocate any particular kind of behavior. I think most people in the Libertarian Party are highly moral. Their moral standards may differ according to their upbringing and their conviction, but most people are moral. And we would expect in a totally free society morality to be a very high standard.
Well, I don't think that the question before the House is whether individual people who follow your movement have high moral standards. It's really a question of what sanctions do they agree to impose on people whose standards differ markedly from their own. Now, we would agree that under a society ushered in by the Libertarian Party, there would be, for instance, no state sanctions against, say, a free use of morphine.
That's correct.
And there would be no sanctions against a failure of parents to educate their children.
That's correct.
There would be no sanctions whatsoever against the failure of certainly not no sanctions against any form of obscenity or.
Well, that's certainly so, Bill. Mm-hmm. It's necessary as a concomitant of the principle of individual liberty that society not impose on anyone who is peacefully engaging in voluntary acts. You know, I presume, that morphine, heroin, and other hard drugs were perfectly legal in this country until 1914, when the Wilson administration passed the Harrison Narcotics Act. That the great problems we've had with drugs since in this country has arisen since then as a product of the prohibition. There was no problem beforehand.
Yes, and I'm sure you know, Roger, that morphine didn't exist in 1910. Would there be any laws against sedition?
In what form? You mean actually taking up arms and attacking an individual who is a member of the government?
Or siding with an enemy in time of war?
Well, I should imagine that it would be necessary in the very limited sphere of activity that we would accord the federal government that those who were out to destroy it in time of war would be subject to the same sanctions as the putative enemy. Mm-hmm. Our libertarian foreign policy, however, doesn't encompass the kind of thing that has become common in this country since 1917, when the Wilsonian interventionist foreign policy became the order of the day. We look toward a foreign policy of neutrality. We believe in disengagement from the world. We believe in political neutrality akin to that set forth for this country by Presidents Washington and Jefferson. We look for a sufficient nuclear deterrent in the form of nuclear stability to prevent any nation from ever attacking this country. And combining that with our policy of non-intervention anywhere else around the world, it would seem to me quite unlikely that this country will again be at war.
Well, but it becomes a matter of collective judgment. What, in fact, is the most intelligent line of military defense? There might even be libertarians in your strict definition of the term who would say we should be prepared to go to war for Bermuda, because if they come any closer to us than Bermuda, we would find ourselves fighting in Annapolis, and that would be unpleasant. Now, would you permit strategic judgments of that kind to override your commitment to, quote, neutrality about what happens in other parts of the world?
No, I think that's essential. I doubt that those judgments would come into play, however, because there's only one nation in the world, at least in the current situation, that would even contemplate an aggression against the United States, and of course that was the Soviet Union. With the kind of deterrent force that we now have in existence, 41 submarines more or less constantly at sea, each one of which, from one of its many nuclear missile warheads, can destroy most of the cities of the Soviet Union, it seems to me extremely unlikely that the Soviet Union would attempt to take Bermuda or Ottawa or Mexico City.
Well, it's not only extremely unlikely, but a historical fact that they have in recent history attempted to take over Cuba and succeeded in doing so, and that they sponsored an aggressive war, the purpose of which is to control Angola, and that they are engaged in various pressure points throughout the globe in such a way as precisely to reduce us to the alternative of using one of your submarines, or which would in turn invite a devastating rebuttal with the final strategic purpose of causing us simply to surrender by attrition. Now, the reason I mention this is not because I want to get into military strategy. I simply want to ask whether there is a dogmatic position in libertarian theory on the use of military intelligence, even if it requires you to exert yourself outside the territory limits of the United States. I gather there isn't.
No, of course not. But the examples you cite, to me, demonstrate the precise opposite of the conclusion you seem to draw from them. The Soviet Union did not invade Cuba, did not invade Angola, and had no armies in Vietnam.
It uses surrogates.
Certainly, it uses surrogates. It attempts to promote and export its revolution, which is, of course, invidious to everything that libertarians stand for. But Brezhnev reiterated in February the Leninist doctrine, which was that the Soviet Union will not be involved in aggressive foreign military adventures itself. And it seems to me, so long as they do use surrogates.
How does that incorporate the facts in Czechoslovakia and Hungary?
Well, I think they now regard those countries as pretty well within their sphere of military influence. The one time that they,
well, don't you think they do
went abroad with an aggressive military experience was the time when they were allies with Soviet, with Nazi Germany, and they found out that much of Russia would defect. I think that lesson is not lost on them. The point is, they're biting off the Cubas, they're biting off the Angolas and places like this, not primarily through military might, neither their own nor the winners in those conflicts, but through a set of ideas. The communists have a systematic set of ideas about human life and the condition on this earth, which we are not meeting in this country. Libertarianism is the precise opposite of communism. And it is by advocating that opposite set of ideas, the reality of human liberty, the necessity of human freedom, that we're going to bring to a halt these bit-by-bit bite-offs of the communist empire.
Well, I think that that sounds good. And as someone who has been urging the Republican Party in the direction of libertarianism for 25 years, I'm substantially in agreement with you. I disagree, I suppose, in respect to the proposition that in order to be convincingly anti-communist, it is required that we face the communist challenge at a number of levels, that these are, as you suggest, paramilitary rather than military, but unfortunately have by and large to be executed by the government, there being no sort of freelance agency that takes the role of, say, NATO or the CIA or whatever? Or do you have a solution to
it? It may be that those would arise, just as before the Second World War, Americans served in the Lafayette Escadrille and similar organizations abroad. I put it to you that our history of interventions, at least in the last decade, have been pretty disastrous. The policy of intervening in Angola was called to an abrupt halt. The policy of doing what we did in Cuba brought disaster there. Vietnam has fallen. Isn't it time to contemplate whether maybe the raising of a standard for the rest of the world, which is the exact opposite of the tyranny of communism, may in fact be our ultimate salvation?
You know, it seems to me that what is manifestly wrong about that kind of optimism is the synthetic historical nature of it. Anybody who needs a further demonstration that life in the United States, notwithstanding the long accretion of bureaucratic impositions of the last 100, 200 years, is preferable to life in East Germany, say, is asking for supererogatory proof. If you can't be persuaded that it is better to live under an American type system than under the kind of system that prevails behind the Iron Curtain, any improvement in our system is not likely to have that incremental epistemological effect that you think it is. And that's the problem. You simply are assuming that all we have to do in order to be an effective tropism for the loyalties of all men is to increase the amount of freedom that we have by, for instance, permitting Lester Maddox to refuse to serve a black man who wants one of his pieces of fried chicken. I don't really think that that would necessarily
I think that's a cheap shot, Bill. Why couldn't we make it Elijah Muhammad and his refusal to serve a white man?
If it's a cheap shot, why did you list it in your platform?
I think you're dead wrong, Bill. I think that that's the only thing that's going to change the world balance. And I think we have an example for it. It was this country that, in 1776, exemplified to the world this idea of the right of each individual to life, to liberty, and to the pursuit of happiness. It rejected the notion that an authority, in the case of this country, King George, either had the right to tell us how to live or could, in fact, successfully tell us how to live. That philosophy prevailed, and throughout the last century, millions upon millions of Europeans came to this country in order to take advantage of the freedom we had here. We emptied villages in Ireland, the Ukraine, Italy. And those who couldn't come stayed home and tried to move their systems in the direction of classical liberalism to emulate ours.
I don't think
Can
it was
it not
so
happen
much,
again?
I don't think it was so much a question of our telling the world how that George III wasn't going to tell us how to live. It was about telling the world that George III wasn't going to tell us how to govern ourselves. And there is, of course, an important difference between the two concepts. After all, we launched our experiment 200 years ago with a considerable number of human beings who were slaves. So we began right off with a rather incandescent qualification on the whole notion of human freedom. Not only that, those countries in the world that began emulating us were inspired primarily by our anti-colonialism, not by our Bill of Rights, as witness the rather weak experience of Latin America, which a generation later followed us historically, but did not bring anything like universal freedom.
Well, I can't defend those who misunderstood what this country was about. I can simply point to those who did understand, who came here,
like who?
And those 40, 50 million people between 1850 and 1900.
Well, they
the
came
numerous people in Latin America who tried somehow to figure out what was working about the American
They came here to avoid government action with which they were out of sympathy, right? And to look for greater opportunity. But the revolutions those who tried to simulate the American Revolution were really separated into two strands, weren't they? One was the French strand, which was itself a radical and in a sense aspired for that discontinuity that offended Burke. Ours did not aspire for that discontinuity. But the long train of anti-colonialism that was ushered in by the American example was unfortunately not all that closely related to libertarianism, was it?
Well, I take a different view again, Bill. I think I view this last two centuries as an action and reaction process. Mm. The American Revolution was, as I said, one for individual freedom. There was an attempt to export that to France. As you remember, Thomas Paine sat in the General Assembly, the States General. But when Paine and Lafayette lost, the French Revolution became totally totalitarian. It was in reaction to the American idea. And early, in fact, through most of the last century, the American idea of freedom stumblingly was put into place in much of the Western world. England became liberal, France became liberal. And then, of course, with perhaps the revolutions of 1848, the intellectual tide began to turn back more towards authoritarianism of a new strand, what we now think of as socialism and communism. I think that tide has reached its apogee. I think it's already beginning, the first signs of it are showing, to wash back again. And I think the growth of this Libertarian Party, which in 4 years has come from the puny beginnings that you suggest in your introduction, to the fact that we'll now be on the ballot in 40 rather than the 35 states you mentioned, and that we're organized in every state, and that we're attracting young people left and right. We have 150 young libertarian alliances now across the country, and innumerable other signs suggest that the...
Excuse me. You were saying that there were other signs of the growth of the party.
Yes, that the tide has turned. People are looking toward liberty now.
Well, I have maintained for a long time, and I suspect you're in sympathy with that general contention, that much that has destroyed the force of liberalism is its failure to perform. And in the last period, a great many people have recognized its apparent impotence and are looking elsewhere. I think, however, that they are turned off the kind of libertarianism that is characterized by your movement, by a suspicion that it suffers itself from the same kind of vanities that liberalism suffers from. The kind of liberalism that says we will affect the quality of your life, as Lyndon Johnson promised to do for us, is not, they think, probably all that different from the kind of libertarianism that says by simply permitting everybody to do everything that everybody wants to do, everybody is going to be happy. And it may be a very important shared intuition by people that doesn't necessarily follow from pure permissiveness. There are arguments for permissiveness, but they ought to be unrelated to any promise that happiness results.
Well, I haven't found that. As I've traveled around the country, I've encountered a great many news reporters who are ex-liberals, who may have had stars in their eyes for Mr. McGovern 4 years ago, and which stars no longer are there. And I don't think they see those vanities that you refer to in libertarianism. I think they begin to perceive that there is no political system which is going to guarantee happiness for everyone. That which can come closest is that which lets us all develop our individual lives, as long as we do it peacefully, in whatever way we see fit. That they have matured to that point. They've gone beyond the inconsistencies of liberalism and to a perception that that we're going to have the best world we can have if all of us are allowed to develop according to our capabilities. That doesn't mean all of us are going to do it. That doesn't mean there's not going to be unhappiness, but it offers us all the best chance for it. That was, of course, what was meant by the pursuit of happiness.
Well, you say it offers us all the best chance. I happen to think that you're correct, but I don't think it's easy to face down the arguments of somebody who says, look, just as an example, my desire for happiness is seriously bound up with my desire to know that I live in a society in which I and my children will be cared for in case there is something that incapacitates me or my husband or whoever. Therefore, I would rather live in a state that makes commitments to all of its inhabitants, which are redeemable in the event of this kind of emergency, than in one in which there is all relationships are so atomized that you don't have the fruits of that kind of fraternal concern. How do you handle that argument?
Well, I think there's no doubt that it exists, and very great numbers of people share that attitude. One can't perhaps penetrate the stupidity of people who believe that actually is going to be possible over the long run. And it may be a long time before we can reach a majority agreement with our point of view. Nonetheless, the fact is that the state cannot redeem those commitments, as you say. For example, the Social Security system now is totally bankrupt. None of the other presidential candidates would touch discussing that with a 10-foot pole. But the fact is that its unfunded liabilities are about $4 trillion now. It's a sum that will not be paid off by the government.
Will not be paid off in constant dollars.
Of course, it'll be paid off.
It will be paid off in funny money.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And maybe that perception, when it arrives, will lead some of these people to take a look at
it. But it never arrives.
Society.
It never arrives, does it? That is to say, people still think of themselves as net beneficiaries in New York City. Whenever somebody passes a rapid transit bill in Washington, D.C., and I despair of the moment ever arising that they recognize that it is a form of auto taxation, but it is one the effects of which are in diminished dollars. Now, what makes you think that the great apparatus is around the corner?
Well, I'm not convinced it is, strictly speaking, around the corner. I'd like to say so to this, to you and this audience, but I can't. I think it's a patient matter of education and discussion.
Well, why, how would you handle the notion that, after all, there's been more than a generation of a welfare state in the Scandinavian countries, and that they're not clamoring to get out, except here and there a movie maker or two, and that by and large people are having their hospital bills paid when they're 61 or 2 or 3 or 4.
Well, apart from the fact that there's a new political party in Denmark which wants to throw all this hogwash out and move toward a free economy, and apart from the fact that the Norwegians recently changed the labor government, which has been socialist and in power for umpteen years, apart from those manifestations of a rumbling there, there is the fact that that's the old world. People have always bowed down to king and authority. People have accepted the idea that someone knows better than us, someone can take care of us if we're in trouble.
Well, they don't bow very obsequiously to any king in the Scandinavian countries, much less obsequiously than we do to our president.
I noticed that the king of Sweden didn't put on his crown the other day when he was married. But there is that fundamental notion, which is not American at all,
that they are that they are an etiolated race, while
that they're part of
us,
a,
we're still
an organic community. Yes, that's right.
As you know, there are unfortunately a lot of historians and social commentators, even people who are mentors of ours, like Albert J. Nock, who have said that the United States went from prematurity into senescence without ever experiencing a genuine maturity. If that is true, then indeed we are emulating, and one would certainly think we were by judging the rhetoric of the most fashionable parties of the United States, the rhetoric of the welfarists. We are, roughly speaking in historical terms, about 5-10 years behind the kind of thing they do in England.
In Britain, yes.
Yeah. Now, it may be that such movements as your own, for all that they tend to be a little bit frolicsome in...
Hardly that, Bill.
Well, when you want
I
to...
I have never undertaken harder work than I have for the last 5 months. The 1,000 people running for office...
I meant ideologically frolicsome. When you want to demunicipalize the firefighters, I think that it becomes a seminar rather than a political movement.
Yeah, Bill, ours is a system of priorities. Yeah. We don't throw the baby out before we've found the reason why the baby was in the bath in the first place. Mm-hmm. There's nothing frolicsome about this. We have, as I started to say, 1,000 candidates running for the U.S. Senate, for the Congress, for local offices across the country this year, who are in deadly earnest trying to apply the principles of the party, and you know we call this the party of principle, two individual matters of concern to the people in their constituency. If their houses burn down before the fire department gets there, they raise the question, wouldn't a free enterprise fire department be preferable? And on a national level, I'm attempting to do the same thing.
Would a free enterprise fire department be available to somebody who hadn't subscribed?
Well, I wouldn't think so. In most cases, not. Scottsdale, Arizona has a free enterprise fire department, as you probably know.
Well, they probably have an unlisted police number in Scottsdale. But what about the house next to the house that was burning? Would he have some sort of a derivative protection?
Well, I can't tell you how the market actually would work. Undoubtedly, the house next door, if he subscribed to the Scottsdale Fire Department, would be protected from the spreading of the fire. Mm-hmm. And I suspect that the fire department actually put out the fire in a non-subscriber's house and expect to collect later on. Mm-hmm. But the point is that we're trying to solve these problems. We're not just submitting to a status quo that's gone from bad to worse, to the point where people... 71% of the people, Bill, say to the pollsters, we have no faith in what our politicians are doing. We know that whatever they do, things are going to be worse 2-3 years from now than they are now. We're trying, at least, to answer those problems.
The argument that in a truly rational society, in which everyone has an equal opportunity, and everyone is told to make provisions for any emergencies that might hit him or her in the future, you will find that nine people comply and a tenth does not. Now, because I take you at your word that most of your followers have very, very high moral priorities, there is a sense of responsibility for the tenth, the fellow who didn't squirrel away his savings. The question is, how is it expressed? I don't dare say that it's expressed collectively, even though the concern is expressed collectively. It is, I take it, expressed, therefore, simply by a voluntary contribution by the nine for the benefit of the tenth.
Certainly.
That's correct. Now, to the extent that, there is, hypothetically, an excess of demand by the impoverished over the supply of philanthropic impulse, what happens?
We don't concede that that's very apt to happen.
Don't challenge the hypothesis, Roger.
I must challenge the hypothesis because there's no answer.
They don't allow that in Princeton, do they? Yeah.
They did in my day. We got Princeton panelists here?
Yes, substantially. No,
it never happened in this country before welfare became a government institution, even in the days when there was very little capital in this country, where people were really living hand to mouth, as perhaps the readers of the Laura Ingalls Wilder's books know was the case in this country a century ago. Even then, the poor of little towns like De Smet, South Dakota, those who couldn't take care of themselves, were taken care of, either by the philanthropy of some individual or by a group of people who would chip in and erect and maintain what was called the poorhouse. I have no doubt with the great increase in capital in this country and the greatly elevated standards we have today that the needs of any very small minority of people who can't help themselves would be taken care of. And as for those that won't take care of themselves, let them suffer the consequence.
Well, if you have a situation in which there is a substantial depression and there isn't a residue available to take care of those who cannot take care of themselves, do you then shift gears and say this is a social emergency and we attach at least temporarily priority to the requirement to help these few people, meanwhile suspending, as even as one would in a war, our rights to decline to help the collectivity? Or would you take the dogmatic answer that under no circumstances whatsoever would you be entitled to call on a member of your society for contributions in charity?
Yes, we'd take that latter view. In a depression, you've gone at the question a little backward from the way a libertarian would. There is no end to the human needs that have to be satisfied. And so long as you and I want something done for us, and so long as there are people...
You mean appetite?
Appetite, certainly, yeah.
You not want to have to be satisfied.
You want a new sail for your yacht, I want a new propeller for my airplane, down to very simple things like a new record or a French lesson or what may be. So long as we have those demands, and so long as people aren't prohibited from contracting with you at the price you want to pay for that, then there's going to be no situation in which people are widespread, totally and permanently, and without their fault, out of work. We may have to hire them at a dollar an hour rather than the 2.5 they've been getting, but there will be opportunity for them. And even beyond that, most of us are adherents to the Austrian School of Economics, which, as you know, is headed up by Friedrich Hayek, who won the Nobel Prize a couple of years ago, and in this country by Dr. Murray Rothbard. Both of them take the view that it's government intervention in the economy that causes the kind of malinvestment that produces these bad depressions and recessions. And if that's correct, and we are convinced that it is, then any depression in this country would be fleeting and transitory and not deep.
Well, there wasn't, I know their work, I know their analyses. There are anomalies, that is to say, there are depressions which are not fully accounted for, so far as I am aware, by the Miesian analysis. But you do, I think, have to observe this distinction, which is that although it is true that human appetite is never satisfied, there's always something left over that people want, and that this generates, in a context of a limited economic supply, the kind of energy that causes a dynamism. Nevertheless, that has to be a felt demand. To demand something abstractly does not generate somebody into giving it to you. If you want a skateboard, nobody is going to exert himself to give you a skateboard unless you can pay for it. So the difference between your desire and your felt desire is a crucial economic difference. And if you don't have a felt desire, which you wouldn't have in a situation in which you were chronically unemployed, you would suffer from the deterioration in that economic cycle, would you not?
Well, the felt desire always takes place, even in the depth of the Depression. Some of my ancestors have described to me how people would come up and ask to rake the walk for a nickel. Well, they could afford a nickel, and they could express, I want my walk cleaned in the form of a felt desire with the nickel, which, of course, in those days was considerably more than it is today, and enabled that person, may perhaps, to have the meal that carried him through that half day. Now, we're angling off in an area that's seems to me a little unproductive, situations that existed a half a century and more ago and which are marginally comparative to what the kind of society we would have if there were a libertarian society today. The growth of capital, the increase in population, the proliferation of technology all suggest that in the event of a temporary recession, without the government's trying to put a floor under our ability to express our demand, that people would go on living, albeit at a reduced standard, for a few months, a year, and then would see a recrudescence of what they had before.
There are certainly advantages to the technological purchase that we have in our time that we didn't have in other times. A dishwasher will perform much more efficiently than five people could perform 25 years ago. But it is also true that the capitalization per job has correspondingly increased, and that under the circumstances there is a certain polarity between the services of a skilled and an unskilled laborer. This can reasonably be said to have the effect of having the fellow who comes to you to rake your leaves be worth very little to you in terms of what you could afford to give him, which he could then pass along in the form of rent or in the form of payments to his grocer. And that may be, or so it is argued, a role that only the government can fulfill. The social credit people play with that whole notion,
don't they?
As you know. Mm-hmm. Well, your party then, your party expects to advertise the planks as described by Kilpatrick in the introduction.
Well, as you know, he's something of a curmudgeon, and he was having a lot of fun at our expense, mixing
anything
in
but a curmudgeon.
Mixing in accurately some of the things he said, and in a sneering way some of the other things that he said. Of course, nothing there that's totally wrong. One wants to take plank by plank and discuss these things in order to show where things have gone wrong and how our proposals will hopefully set them right.
We'll go to Mr. Ned Potter from Princeton. Mr. Potter.
Mr. MacBride, when you see a beggar on the street begging for coins, do you give him money?
Sometimes, sometimes not.
Well, the reason I ask is that I usually don't. I get a little scared and I scurry by him, and later when I'm in a safe place, I feel guilty about it. I feel perhaps I should have helped him. Libertarianism, I think, implies that things are going to take care of themselves. I'm talking about economics now. Prices will go down when there's lower demand, but eventually that will bottom out and go on back up. But is that really the case? We've seen in this decade the Dow Jones Industrials have been in the thousands twice.
Oh, we don't have a free market economy now. There's nothing to be discussed about what's happened in the last decade and compared to a libertarian free market. The comparison might be roughly the 80 years since between the time that President Jackson abolished the Federal Reserve Bank of its day, the Second Bank of the United States, and its recrudescence under Woodrow Wilson in 1913. And during those 80 years, the price level went steadily down in the relatively free market, and the wage rate rose steadily for 80 years. I would expect that phenomenon to recur.
Well, I've heard it said that in the late 19th century, everybody was a little bit uncomfortable with those dropping prices. But if I can take this to a more basic level...
I wouldn't be. If it were cheaper today to buy my skateboard than yesterday, I wouldn't be uncomfortable.
Admittedly, my source is Paul Samuelson. Well, I understand there are people starving in this world, and the...
In this country or in this world, or did you mean to distinguish?
In this world, well, I think we don't even need to make a distinction. I don't know if this is true, but I understand that there are even some in this country. My question is, would they be all right? I do feel a responsibility to my fellow man.
Well, so do I. Your question is, should I force the other people in this audience to disgorge against their will some of what they've rightfully earned in order that I can satisfy my feeling that the starving person over there ought to have their money? I say no. Libertarianism says no. What we do say is that the audience and I, seeing this starving person, most all of us, would choose to help him, and would.
In the first place, that would be a democratic presumption. That is to say, if a free society chooses to remit a sum of money for relief purposes, it is assumed that it is the majority of the people voting to tax themselves to that effect.
Well, we do vote for our president.
As Bill implies, the assumption is if that's now the case, then that same majority would help
on
voluntary
automatically,
basis.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mr. Nicholas Ulanov is also from Princeton. Mr. Ulanov?
I'm basically appalled at what you're advocating. It seems to me a little bit like a precocious child who says, well, I'm pretty intelligent and I'm capable of taking care of myself and I don't need a babysitter and I don't need to be coddled. I want to be left alone. I want to be given responsibilities. But you don't really want to exercise responsibilities. You have to recognize, I think, as I do, and I think every other individual has to, that not everyone is as responsible or intelligent as you may be. And that part of exercising responsibilities is indeed to recognize that maybe you have to be limited because somebody else has to be limited. You might not need that limitation. You might be able to vote at 14 years of age. But in order to make a uniform system that works functionally in a society, you have to set limits. You seem to me to be setting limits for yourself.
You're saying have to do this, have to do that. What is this categorical imperative?
The categorical imperative, I think, is a responsibility to fellow man.
Well,
it seems to me that you don't believe you have
a
responsibility to other people.
Well, I think you need to go back to school. Princeton must be a different place from in my day. Or is he the Yaley?
No, I'm from Princeton.
We feel very strongly in self-reliance and in self-responsibility. And the thing
is,
there's an innumerable amount of literature with which much of which Bill is perfectly familiar with, which suggests that in the field of economics, leaving aside other areas, a free market economy comes much closer to producing the maximum amount of goods and distributing them as widely as possible to all economic groups as any system ever devised in the history of mankind. And far from being irresponsible, the most responsible thing that a libertarian can do is advocate the successful economic system.
The one problem I think you're ignoring is that not everyone is going to recognize their
sure,
part
that's
of society.
Sure, that's why we have Salvation Armies. That's
but what
why
happens
we have
if,
church
what happens
missions.
If the Salvation
the
Army
Mormon
can't
church
get any corporals?
Takes care of its own. They're
what happens if the Salvation Army can't get any corporals? What happens if it can't get any troops in some town, in some place,
well,
at some
point?
That's
never happened.
It has
never
happened. It has happened, and I suggest...
Yeah, it would have to be.
I suggest that you perhaps have ignored areas of this country. You've ignored certainly areas...
I haven't any doubt that in a free society and in a free economy, humanitarian missions would be simply everywhere. We would, of course, all of us have the 40% of our income that is taken now by the government from us to expend not only on expanded personal satisfactions, but also an intangible one, such as helping those who cannot or will not help themselves.
And you also have the freedom to say that I shall not help this person, and this person may very well starve or commit a crime. So long as he doesn't infringe upon me, I won't infringe upon him.
Only if that was the marginal contribution.
Absolutely.
But he declines to accept the notion that it would be. He's saying, in effect, if there were a marginal factor here, others would give more.
Yeah, the difficulty with that, I think, is that it assumes a rosy outlook of human beinghood, that you pride yourself perhaps on of possessing, but not everyone does.
And it seems to me
you're an idealist.
Rosy idea view of humanhood. Human beings are rotten, they're wonderful, and they're everything in between. And it would be a fatuous outlook.
And let's hope for a good mix.
Beg your pardon?
And let's hope for a good mix, because
that
doesn't work.
We're going to get the mix whether we like it or not. And all the great philosophical systems have had to face that fact, that we deal with reality, not with a Pollyanna-ish view of human nature. And hopefully that's what the Libertarian Party is doing.
Mr. Jonathan Kaufman is from Yale. Mr. Kaufman.
Yeah, you call yourself the party of principle. It seems that you neatly avoid practicality. If you have, for example, you don't have compulsory education, don't you, in effect, make a child the prisoner of his parents? A parent decides, you know, I want him to work on the farm, or I want him to go out and get a job. I mean, I don't see where his freedom lies.
Well, now, we're opposed to tax-supported, monopoly, compulsory school systems, which I think most everybody in the country would begin to recognize has failed, because they are a monopoly. Unless you're rich, most parents can't send their child anywhere but to the school that's provided now by the state. We'd like to begin the process of introducing alternatives, independent schools, religious schools, and whatnot. Now, as far as the child's being a prisoner of his parents are concerned, we have two cases. The 99.9% of parents in this country, and almost certainly of the world, who are anxious for their child to do well. So they're anxious for their child to attend school and mature themselves, if for no other reason than so they can help support mom and dad in their old age, if the state isn't there to do it. That tiny fraction of 1%, we take the view, and I can't say that I work this out thoroughly, but many of the libertarian philosophers have taken the view that the child, when it reaches a point at which it is physically capable of independent existence, if it wants to leave the family, can do so. And at that point, of course, would be in a position to provide for its own schooling. Of course, it's hard cases that make difficult questions, and yours is just that. We can try to tackle these things as we implement the change. We can only talk about the tremendous benefits that a major reform would make.
Mr. Potter?
I'd like to take this a bit further. Have you ever known anybody who made his living as a criminal or as a beggar, for that matter?
Sure. I practiced law in Vermont. And, I knew both. One of them came after me with a gun one night when I didn't handle his case the way he thought it would be handled.
Well, I think you're leading me where I want to go. You said earlier that human beings are marvelous and they're terrible and they're everything in between. And I would certainly agree with that statement verbatim. But I think, well, humanity is, to make a bad analogy, like the universe. That is to say that the universe is a lot of empty space punctuated by concentrations of matter. In other words, there's polarization. And I think rather than an absolute equilibrium in society, we do get that same kind of polarization. If we had a free market, we would naturally get large corporations trying to form themselves, as happened in the 19th century, and we would have people out on the street. I don't know a society which has been free of beggars.
Well, I don't take your point. There's no question there.
Well, China has no beggars. They're not allowed.
That's the opposite of libertarianism.
Yes. Yes, it is. Yeah. I'm not sure I got your question either. Did you get it, Roger?
No, I didn't.
Yeah.
I could give a counter discourse, but I doubt it would be useful.
give us the question, part of the question again, on the matter of the beggars.
What I'm trying to echo is what Nick said a minute ago, which is that I don't think it would be true that 99.9% of the people in a free market economy would want to send their children to school. And I don't think it's true that the vast majority of people would want to help out other people. I think insecurity is a major motivation for anybody in any kind of economy, and I think that would continue to manifest itself.
Well, it might indeed. I would expect institutions to grow up to take care of that. I would expect your local church to use peer pressure on parents who didn't want to send their children to school, to send them to a church school or a local charity school of some
but
sort.
But here we have an elected government, which ideally in the original formation, perhaps not now, was supposed to be by, of, for the people, which in the consumption which has grown up in this century was supposed to take care of that.
Well, now that's exactly what the Libertarian Party is dead opposed to. Our whole proposition, our whole reason for being is that we have a right to run our own lives and no one has a right to run them for us. Of course people who want to run our lives tell us always it's in our own good. You mustn't smoke a joint, you mustn't read that book, you must go to school, and you must go to this school too, and this school must have that curriculum too. They all say it in terms of your own good. We say it's time for that notion to begin to recede in world history.
Well, may I ask one last version of this question? Let's say the activist liberal government, which we've had since about the 1930s, had not botched everything up.
I date it back to Woodrow Wilson.
We can take it back further. Let's say it had not made a mess of everything, and we actually did not have poverty in this country now.
Well, it's a condition contrary to fact. What question? What if it hadn't? Then it would be longer before, no doubt, the Libertarian Party's ideas of freedom would prevail. It's the fact that they did botch, the fact that it can't work. Conventional liberalism combines some respect for civil liberty, the right of an individual to live his own life, with a nutty attitude about the economy, that it ought to be controlled, that the big boys, the corporations, ought to be patted on the back. It's a system that cannot work, that carries the seeds of its destruction, and it is being destroyed now.
Mr. Ulanov.
I believe you that on occasion, perhaps most of the time, people will take care of problems that exist, that if you will, Gulf Oil will clean up the bayous of Louisiana and make them smell pretty and the birds chirp. But I also put it to you that on occasion, Gulf Oil and Standard Oil is going to stink up New Jersey, where we've both gone to school. It seems to me that free market, yeah, absolutely, and we agree that in a free market, sooner or later, forces tend to take care of existing problems or areas that need shoring up. But meanwhile, those areas suffer, and I put it to you.
Excuse me, it's not part of libertarian philosophy to permit anybody to dump on air that is owned by the community or on water that is owned by the community.
No, but it might be part of the libertarian philosophy not to really empower anyone to.
Well, again, we get into a nutty question. In the ultimate sense, what we think is the answer to pollutants is to find a way to privatize all sectors of existence, in effect, so that if I pollute your backyard, well, it's analogous to my having a barbecue in my backyard. You erect a pig slaughtering plant in your backyard, and as I go out with Bill to have a cocktail, a greasy smoke rolls over my barbecue. Well, it's my airspace and my yard, and I should have access to the courts to prevent you from doing that.
Why not erect a wall?
Well, that doesn't keep the smoke out. That is not something that's going to be able to do in the case of minute bits of pollution that affect the oceans, the Great Lakes, and the air. And until we found an alternative that's more successful, of course, there is a role for the government to prevent Gulf Oil from cost-free stinking up our atmosphere.
Yeah, it is undeniably the custodian of that which we have in common and which is inseparable, like air. You agree?
I'll go along with
even,
that until we find a better
Watts
answer.
Agrees on that. Mr. Kaufman.
What happens when individual liberties conflict, where a manufacturer feels that it's best for him to make a product that he can get away with selling but will fall apart later, and the consumer's right to know that what he's buying will hold up? Who decides that?
You're putting in a false antagonism here. There's no conflicting of individual liberty. The consumer has no right to know it's not going to fall apart tomorrow. He has the right to find out whether it's going to fall apart tomorrow. And if he's denied that right, then, of course, he's denied his individual liberty.
And he can certainly subscribe to a freely organized agency in which the record of the producer of this particular product is advertised, right?
Such as Consumers Union, such as Underwriters Laboratory, and you even have the spectacle, of course, of someone as like Ralph Nader, who found one product, in his opinion, to be defective. It would fall apart tomorrow, figuratively speaking, and he caused a giant automobile corporation to discontinue the Corvair forever. The free market provides many opportunities.
But yet they're still recalling cars, even today, so many years after that.
Well, there you are. The manufacturers have been brought to their attention. This wasn't a product that was satisfactory in some regard, and they're calling it back and fixing it.
Sure.
I wish the university the state-owned universities would recall some of their students. Oh, we have time for another quick one. Oh, did I interrupt you?
No, it's okay. Yeah.
A couple of months ago at Princeton, I read about a man named George Kennan who went to the same school as we did and was largely responsible for our Cold War policy. He said something to the American government to the effect of, the Russians don't seem to respond to our ideals, and he advocated a very strong containment position. Now, what you're saying is you don't think the Russians are that much of a threat, that as long as we have an
No, I'm not saying that at all. My ideas are rather like those of Earl Ravenel, if you want a prominent figure in the foreign policy field to refer to in the future, and totally different from those of people like Zbigniew Brzezinski and George Ball and all the rest of them. We believe firmly in not in a containment policy, but one of disengagement done in an orderly fashion and political neutrality thereafter.
With nuclear weapons at the ready?
Well, of course, there's a great raging debate as to what kind of nuclear deterrence one needs. The James Schlesinger group, he's advising Ronald Reagan at the moment, advocate selective first strike capability. I myself am convinced that the other school is correct and that a stable nuclear deterrent, probably in the form of a triad of submarine-launched missiles, land-launched, and airplane-launched missiles, are sufficient to ensure that no country is going to think of attacking the United States.
Well, after Mr. Kennan and his government decided to have a nuclear deterrent against the Russians, they observed, and this is their view, that the Soviets were slowly creeping into Eastern Europe, biting off little chunks, and here we were ready to lay them flat, and that certainly wasn't appropriate to this little biting off, which you admitted earlier, too.
We have 30 seconds, Roger.
Well, I don't propose that I tax everybody in the United States and conscript everybody in the United States in order to carry out George Kennan's or your foreign policy in the eastern part of Europe. NATO can take care of itself, and we should take care of ourselves.
Thank you very much, Mr. MacBride. Thank you, gentlemen of the panel. Thank you all.
Printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content and was funded in part by public television stations.